Now, as a student, I can opt for any of the topic as per my choice, but it is always advisable that the year 2020 in which we are living and the coming years ahead, we should pick a topic which is more relevant and which is of current hot topic in the industry as such. So we'll discuss some of the topics which we can pick here as such and start working on it so that process of mentor allocation also becomes easy for us. First thing we can work on, first topic is the cloud computing topic. Now, initially in the early years, there were a lot of theory about the cloud computing. But nowadays, many number of simulators are available wherein I can do the simulation for the cloud computing environment. Now, those of you who might have worked on something in cloud computing domain, we have got three kind of paradigms in it. We will have a software as a service, platform as a service, and infrastructure as a service. There are many other more domain in cloud computing, but these three are the basic ones as such. So now, if I want to do some programming in it, I would like to, let's say, design an application and then deploy it onto the servers in the cloud computing domain. Then first thing first, we need to study theory of it, that we are comfortable and confident enough to work in a cloud computing domain. So let's say initially 15 to 20 days, we study only the theoretical aspect of it. Now, once we are comfortable with the theory of it, then we can start working on any of the cloud computing simulators. One of the widely used simulator is a Windows Azure. It comes as a part of the Visual Studio package. So we can download the Visual Studio IDE from the web. Now, since Visual Studio has a backing of the Microsoft, it is their product. So definitely it has a very bright future. So don't worry about it. If I do some project here, it will not be relevant in the years to come because the company backing is Microsoft. So you can always believe that yes, the project has a bright future ahead and you can start working on it and try to design platform as a service or infrastructure as a service based application as such. If I don't want to do on Azure, I can go for the AWS. Now, AWS has a backing of Amazon. So again, we can conclude that since it is a backing of the Amazon, which is a multi-million dollar company, again, AWS has a strong financial backing. But then working on it requires a certain expenditure as such. For example, if I want to create an account in the AWS, I will have to enter the credit card information. So you will have to enter your parents' credit card information so that you can start working on the AWS. But the charges are nominal, so they don't charge very heavily. So even if I start working in the month of August, and let's say my project finishes in November, they will not charge on per day basis per login hour. So if you spend 40 login hours or 50 login hours, so accordingly they will charge. And it's not very expensive. So maybe in 1,000 rupees, you'll be able to complete your entire project by deploying it on the Amazon server as such. Third option for cloud computing is Cloud Sim Simulator. It's a very good simulator. Primarily, coding has been done in Java. So if I work in a cloud computing domain and I choose Cloud Sim as a simulator, then I should be very comfortable with Java programming language. It means what are packages, what is inheritance, how does it support all these things, how does it work, what are threads, because it will talk of these things in a great detail. So we should be comfortable working in Java programming language because the entire simulator is based in Java. And the good thing about this simulator is it has an Indian touch. There was a person by the name Rajkumar Bhuiya. He is an Indian based in Western Australia. He founded a company called Manjra Soft. So Manjra Soft has rolled out two products. Rather, there are many products, but two are widely used. One is Aneka, but which is a proprietary and the paid. And the Cloud Sim is a free of cost. So you can download this simulator and then do the coding in it. Now there are many examples which are free of cost in this simulator. So you don't have to pay anything to anybody. It's a free and open source of FOSS-based simulator. So there are around eight programs that comes with it. You can run those programs and then accordingly customize the code because the bare skeletal code is already available. So you need to understand that code, that what are CPUs, what is RAM, how do we configure them. Because I've worked on it, so I'm very confident on it that you will not have any problem working on the Cloud Sim simulators as well. And the programs are also simple to understand. Documentation is also on the web, so you can actually start working on it. Now, these three are not the only simulator. There are many, many more simulators also for cloud computing. Like IBM has got their own. IBM simulator is also free of cost. That comes with a trial license version. So their enterprise edition is paid, but the trial license is free of cost, so you can download them. EC2 is there, so Elastic Computing, so even you can download them. So you can use any of the simulators that supports the cloud computing fundamentals as such. this will be a very good project, relevant in this year as well as in the coming year, because cloud computing is here to stay. And you can plan your project not only for 7th semester, but also for the 8th semester. So because these projects require time, effort, as well as energy. So they're not hush-hush project that you do it very fast. They require time. So you can plan your project, minor project in this semester and major project in the next semester, so that you become comfortable working in the cloud computing domain and the project will be worth for. Then the other topic on which a student can actually plan to do a project is IoT, what we call the Internet of Things. Now, there are two domains on which a student can explore. One is a software track and the other is a hardware track. Now, if I go on a software track, all the information about sensors, positioning of the sensors, the range or the diameter of transmission range, how to carry out the communication between the two sensors, the routing of the messages, everything has to be studied, and then only you can plan to actually carry out the program inquiry. So there's a very good Java-based cup carbon simulator. Again, it is a free of cost. You can download it from the net and you can open the Eclipse IDE, because normally for Java, we use Eclipse or the NetBeans as IDE for carrying out a programming. So we can open the cup carbon simulator and customize it within the Eclipse IDE and carry out the changes in it. First of all, we need to understand what are the core programs they've already given. We need to understand them, how do they work, how do we need to configure the cup carbon simulator. Once we are through with the basics, then we can actually start customizing it and start using it for carrying out the IoT based projects. Other is for routing of the messages in IoT. Now, since you've already studied the networks, we should be able to understand the importance of the protocols. So we have got two kind of protocols supported for routing in IoT. One is MQTT, the message queue telemetry transport, and the other is a COAP, that is constraint application protocol. So let us say, as a student, I would like to do a IoT based project for routing of messages using a MQTT protocol. So what do I do first? First of all, study the theoretical aspect of it. What is IoT? When did it came? What is the purpose? What are the applications of it? What are the merits and demerits of it? What all is possible in it? What is not possible with it? And then I start working on the routing of the messages as such. So MQTT protocol can be used. It's a free of cost. I can download the PAHO client, P-A-H-O. PAHO is a software client provided for carrying out the MQTT protocol programming in the IoT. So it's a very good protocol which you can use it. And there are other simulators also, the software track. These are only two simulators which I am discussing. There are many other simulators that supports the IoT programming on the software side. Then on the hardware side, which I think many of you are already familiar with, we have Arduino and the Raspberry kits. So you can purchase them, sensors, you can purchase the various kind of the, and then you can carry out a program. But I don't know how many of you are actually comfortable with the hardware track. So as a CSC student, it's always better to go with the software track rather than the hardware track. But then it's up to your choice. If you want to explore on the hardware side of the IoT, you can purchase the kits and start carrying out a configuration and simulation of them, or the emulation, because when we do a program on a hardware, we call it the emulation. Then moving on, we can come to the security track of the IT industry. Now it's a very evergreen track, because it was always said that it's very difficult to design and develop 100% bug-free or the error-free or defect-free software as such. So software always has malfunctioning, and software is also vulnerable to various threats and attacks. So we can use the basic principles of cryptography. So cryptography is a very good branch of computer science that talks of the security of the data. So they provide many encryption and decryption techniques. Like we'll have Caesar cipher, Wiener cipher, rail fence cipher, affine cipher. So we can use some of these techniques for carrying out the security of the plain text. So what do we normally do? We take a plain text as an input from the user and then apply the encryption technique. It gives us a cipher text. Then we send the cipher text to the destination. At the destination, the person who is handling the task will apply the decryption technique and then decipher the data as such. It's a full-fledged track that wherein data flows securely from the source to the destination. Now, once I'm comfortable with the techniques, then I can move on to the algorithms. So we've got two broad categories of the algorithm, symmetric as well as the asymmetric algorithm. Now, symmetric algorithm says we use a single key for carrying out encryption and decryption. And asymmetric algorithm says we use a pair of keys for carrying out encryption and decryption. So we use DES algorithm, data encryption standard algorithm. We use AES algorithm, advanced encryption standard algorithm. And for the asymmetric side, we go to RSA, Rivest-Shamir and the Edelman algorithms. So they're all worldwide popular algorithms which we can use for carrying out the encryption and the decryption of the plain text as such. The nowadays very popular is cybersecurity. And cybersecurity, we talks of the various threats and attacks. So if you Google on the web, there's something called OWASP, OWASP, Open Web Access Security Project. They have identified top 10 vulnerabilities which are normally there in any of the programs, maybe designed in C++ or maybe designed in the Java or maybe web-based programs as such. So we can study those OWASP top 10 vulnerabilities and then plan to simulate some of them on our C++ or Java code or the web-based code as such. For example, if I want to simulate the attacks, because there are many attacks which are already there, like the brute force attack is there, dictionary attack is there, man-in-the-middle attack is there, birdie attack is there, replay attack is there. So what we normally expect from a professional is that he should be able to, first of all, become a hacker and plan to launch the attack, and then your project gets completed. Other option is that you not only you plan to launch the attack, you also provide a security tips to it, that how your programs can be protected as such. So we'll have a hackers as well as the crackers. So we can go into the, even phishing is there, malware analysis is there, various number of cyber security tools are available on the web, like Keylogger is there, we can download them and then we can do a full-fledged project covering various aspects of the cyber security as such. But then we should be able to enjoy, because this is all network security that comes into picture. So we should be able to enjoy working on the network and we should be able to delve more into the security aspect of the things rather than doing a plain hardcore programming as such. There's also something called VAPT, which is Vulnerability Assessment and Penetration Testing. So what we can do, we can track the software code and run various VAPT tools which are available free of cost, or maybe I can write my own code and scan the program to look out what are the possible vulnerabilities in it. So we say Vulnerability Assessment and Penetration Testing, PT. But then you should also have a good knowledge of software testing, because testing principles will also be involved in it. But then the project, if you do it, it will be good enough. It can span across both the semester, minor project in the 7th semester and major project in the 8th semester, the dissertation track as such. Then link to security, another topic which is actually gaining a very importance nowadays is blockchain technology. So I can design and develop a program that supports the concept of the blockchain. So where do I do a programming? Either in Python, that is preferable, or in the Java. Because Java supports something called Java cryptography architecture. Now, what is the advantage of this architecture? It provides certain hashing algorithms. Like MD5 is their message digest 5, or the SHA algorithm, secure hash algorithms. And blockchain technology is totally based on the concept of hashing. So if as a student, I undertake a project in the blockchain technology, first thing first, I need to study the theory of it. That what is the advantage of blockchain, when did Satoshi Nakamoto design and develop the blockchain 2009, why did he do that, what are the principles of the blockchain technology, then what is the concept of hashing, because every block of the blockchain is hashed twice, first with the previous hash value of the previous block and then the hash value of the current block. So first of all, I study the hashing and then I can use any of the predefined algorithms like the MD5 or the SHA. And then I can apply the hashing technique over the data, which is going to be secured using the blockchain technology as such. So again, it has a very bright future. So if you design and develop a project in the 7th semester and maybe continue in the 8th semester, and if your evaluator comes at the end of the semester and you say that I have done a project in blockchain technology, it is really impressive, because you will be able to impress them with your skills that this is what I have done. Or maybe when you appear for placement interviews in the technical side, so they will definitely ask that what is the project you are doing. So So if you tell them I'm doing a project on cloud computing or IoT or blockchain technology, not only sounds impressive, it is also attractive because all the latest and the recent technologies on which you're doing a project. But then it all requires efforts, but then you have a lot of time. August is going on and your evaluation will happen somewhere in November end or maybe December. So a lot of time is there. You can dig out any of these technology, explore them, and then undertake a project. Then moving on, nowadays hot topic, artificial intelligence. So it will have a lot of deep learning and the machine learning technique. There is a very good paper in 1950, Alan Turing has written. It's called Can Machine Actually Learn? So if you are planning to do a project in machine learning, it's good that you start off with that paper of Alan Turing in 1950s. Because if you see, machine is actually the hardware, and the hardware cannot learn on its own. So it's actually the software programs or the processes that you have to do the training and the testing part of it. So machine word itself is misplaced here, but then it is popular by the same term. So okay, fine, how does it matter? So a good project can be taken in the deep learning. You can go to the neural network part, then design and develop a full-fledged project on it. But then for doing it, we require a good mathematics skill. So only if you're very good in mathematics, maybe on the scale of 1 to 10, somewhere stand 8.5 or 9, then only try your hand with it. And it is always said that the person who is good in mathematics is bound to be good in algorithms, and same hold vice versa. So in this, a lot of mathematics will be required. You have to understand various already predefined algorithms, various techniques like supervised and the unsupervised learning, which are already available. And the various technique inside is like the KNN, the naive bias, the super support vector machines. So first thing, we need to identify the problem which I want to actually do. And then is the problem require the machine learning technique? For example, I want to make a prediction. What will be the rainfall in the next 5 years? So I require a data set. So many number of the data sets are already available. On the Kaggle, we can go. Even data.gov.in will have multiple number of data sets. Even the COVID-19 data sets are available. So we can download any of these authentic data set, the real-time data sets, and then apply any of the supervised or the unsupervised learning technique to solve my problem set. Moving on, other project which can be taken is something, a project design and development using the main stack, which is Mongo, Express, Angular, and the Node.js stack. Some of the students are already working in SDC, so they're already working on the main stack. So you can undertake a project that completes fully design and development on this stack. Even the bootstrap loader can be using it. Then another project which can be taken on the advanced Java technologies like Hibernate and Spring. Though we have not taught them in USIT, but if your interest is there, they're all Java based. So you can explore the documentation on Google, everything is available. You can download the IDEs and then you can start working on this Hibernate and the Spring architectures. And the good project can be designed and developed. Then we've got a C#.NET and the AV.NET combination. I want to again design a software project in maybe library management system, payroll management system, any kind of the management system. So I can write the front-end coding in C#.NET because it provides multiple number of GUI components like radio button, checkbox, list box, text box. So I can design the forms using these components. And then I carry out a database connectivity using AV.NET, that is ActiveX data objects. So full-fledged front-end back-end project can be designed and developed using the C#.NET and the AV.NET technology. Moving on, we can design and develop a project using a web part. So I can use a servlet and JSP. Normally we discuss about the client server architecture, but servlets and the JSP work on the MVC architecture, model, view, and controller architecture. We'll discuss this architecture in our FEDT subject also. So I can design a project in servlets. So it takes up input from the HTML page, the server will be deployed on the web server, and then seamless connection can be done using a GDBC, or I can design a lightweight project using the JSP that works on the view side of the MVC architecture. So even they're open source, you don't have to pay anything to anybody. Good project can be designed and developed using the web. Another project that can be taken is designing a website or any of the web-based application using the ASP.NET. So KVAX server pages, they also support any number of the tools and technologies that help the student to actually design and develop the web pages or a website having, let's say, 2 pages or 4 pages or 6 pages. So a good application can be done with it. So front end will be there, back end will be there. Now, as and when I'm using a Java as a front end tool for doing the coding, it is always advisable I use a Oracle or MySQL as a back end, because there is a really good connectivity mechanism between the Java and the MySQL also. There is a MariaDB also, so many databases are there. Oracle is always there as such. Or if I'm doing a project in C#.NET, it is always advisable I use the SQL Server as a backend, because both the products are by the Microsoft, so very seamless connectivity is there and the data flows smoothly from the front end applications to the backend databases. Or maybe I design a project on PHP, so I can need to download the XAMPP server or the XAMPP server that has an inbuilt support for SQL Server. So I can write my code in the PHP applications and then deploy them or connect it to the backend using the SQL Server as such. So a good project can be designed and development is possible using the web part. Then another track which a student can explore and try to do some development work as a minor project is doing app development. So I can use Android, I can use Flutter, and using these toolkits I can design a full-fledged working application and then deploy them on the mobile phones or the smartphones. But then in all these tracks, whichever project you choose, we should always remember that in this semester, there is no subject. One subject has been laid off. And in place of one subject, the minor project is there. So normally 40 hours is dedicated to one subject. So my project should be somewhere worth for 40 hours. If not 40, at least 35 hours. And you don't have to tell it to anybody. When you will demonstrate your project working, the evaluator will come to know if your project has been, and how much amount of time, the energy and the effort you have put into the project as such. So make sure the project selection which you do is worth for, and the team size which you normally allow is maximum 2 students in a single team, because otherwise if you take a larger team, then it is very difficult for you itself to defend your project in terms of evaluator. If your team size of 4 and not much work has been done, it will definitely go against you. So maximum team size is allowed 2. And then both the students will have to work under a single mentor, a supervisor, so that there is no communication gap from your side as well as from the mentor side as well. So not only this, we can there are many other software projects you can also take depending on your own choice in development. For example, software testing, you can take many projects in that area. But then again, you must have a good knowledge of alpha testing, beta testing, unit testing, integration testing, black box, white box, and testing techniques as well. You can pick up any project in that domain. We can also pick up any of the project in databases. That is also equally good. Like we can have a Hadoop as a backend, because Hadoop is also equally good. So we can design a good development project wherein we can write the script in the backend and take the Hadoop as a back. We can write the script in the front end and take Hadoop as a backend for the deployment of the script. So for certain things, because the operating system also is offered through this project. So depending on my choice, depending on my area of interest, and depending on my comfort level, I should pick up one of the topics. Now, during the project allocation, you will allocate a mentor as far as possible, matching to your area. Now, one thing, another topic is different to the digital image processing. So, DIP can only inform you. For example, you only want to work on the image processing aspect. Even you can take that because it's always a hot topic, providing you have a good knowledge of the mathematics and algorithm and programming. So for working in data sciences, for working in DIPs, math skills are required. So we say mathematics, algorithm and programming. So because it requires a lot of efforts, and you need to require to read the research paper also. And these research papers are all available on the web, because there are ebooks, there are hard copies also, hard books also for these topics. But then these topics are so advanced, they keep on changing. So it's always better to refer to the recent research papers, like IEEE, Springer, ACM, Elsevier, Science Direct. These are all publication houses that publishes the research papers. And if you are good,
maybe in the 8th semester. You can even plan to write your own research papers. So our university supports the publication of research papers by the BTech students. They will also provide a free of cost 100% reimbursement. So if you are interested, I will share the form with you. It's by DSW, Director of Student Welfare. So the 7th semester, so you will have to understand the topic and the subject first. The 8th semester, those of you who are planning to go abroad for MS or you are planning to go for MTech, then they can definitely plan to publish some research paper in national or international conferences. And the entire money, the registration fee for research papers is reimbursed by the university, because the university also supports the publication aspect. And if you look at the students who are pursuing BTech final year from the IIIT or even the NIT or the NSIT, they are also too much into these things. So you can always plan to go ahead and publish some good quality research papers in this particular topic as well. And then, because required research papers means the topic has to be non-WebD. WebD is called web design and development. So you don't have to do much into it. But then if your topic is non-WebD, yes, you can always plan to design or maybe write a research paper after interacting with our mentor and supervisor as well. Now, it may happen that your mentor or supervisor may be in the same area or maybe not in the same area. But as far as possible, we will always make sure that the mentor is in the matching area as what we have opted for. But we can't have 100% mapping. Not all the teachers work on all the technologies. So that is going to be one of problematic area. Another problem area will be, since we don't have a classes in this semester, there will not be any in-person meeting with the mentors or supervisors. So again, it has to be WhatsApp based or telephonic based, or maybe you can have some online tools like Google Classroom or Cisco, and then you can interact with your guides as such. So depending on the topic you have chosen, we'll try to allocate, make sure we'll try our best to allocate a guide of the same area, but it may be possible, it may not be possible. But then ultimately, you should be the driving force for your project. It is your project. So you pick a topic and then you should be very honest with it. Come day, come night, you should still be able to work on your project as such. It's your project, not the guide project. They have already done their BTech, MTech, PhD. So you should be the driving force, and what problems will definitely come in any of the project you choose. But then project should look like an effort has been done by student for 40 hours. And especially those students who are preparing for GATE as well as CAT exam, they need to have good time management skills so that you can work on your minor project as well as without hampering much of your GATE as well as CAT preparation. Because GATE, we still have a time. Next semester it will take place. But CAT will take place definitely in this semester. So it's always advisable that you start early and then start working on the project. Now, as I told you, Shraddha, don't talk to the guide right now. Let the list officially come from the dean office. Then only you interact with the guide, because parallelly the list is being prepared for IT also as well as for the ECE also. So we'll try to strike as balanced as possible. But in the meantime, you can definitely choose a topic. Now, on the Google form which you have submitted, there are many topics of the same type. Almost everyone went for the web development or the website development. So I still give you a day. So tomorrow we'll go for the fresh allocation. If you would like to switch over the topic from any topic from once, you want to jump or switch over from one topic to another topic, you'll always do it. And the other thing which I wanted to share is that I have been told by Dean Office that the allocation will be done on the basis of the percentage you have scored in the last semester. So Ruchi ma'am has already taken that. So tomorrow again, if the class is there tomorrow or if on the Wednesday, we'll again go for fresh allocation and we'll sort the list on the basis of the percentage of marks you have scored till now. But then again, the fundamental principle will remain same, not more than two students under a single teacher. So there could be a reshuffling in that, because some of the students have been allocated the project, but that was on the first come first serve basis, the way you filled in the Google form. But now the entire allocation will be done on the basis of the percentage of the marks you have scored it. So I will go for fresh allocation. I will sort the list, start allocating the topic. If you want to switch over the topic, make it much more relevant in the current scenario. Maybe you want to choose cloud computing, blockchain technology, or the IoT, or data sciences, machine learning, or the digital image processing. You can pick up any of these choices. And then once you pick a choice, then don't change it, because change will not be allowed.
once the list is freezed and finalized, we will not allow the change in this semester. So you have to continue with the topic in this semester. And if you have a problem with the topic and you don't want to continue, then in the eighth semester, in the initial aspect of it, we can go for a change. But once the list is finalized, no change will be accommodated. But the change of topic will only be done in the next semester. So I give you a choice. Take one day more. Think of the topic you want to pursue. If your interest gets alive, good. You can go for the new topic for your choice. And then depending on the percentage, we'll go for the allocation. Still, you have choices of your mentors. If it can be accommodated, we'll definitely give the choice as such. So any questions, anyone? Anything not clear? Anything you want to discuss?
Yes, sir. I want to ask a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
Sir, if two students who are in the same team, if they don't get the same mentors, then what will happen?
No, we will try our best that the same mentor can be allocated. But then again, percentage criteria will come. If one student,
yes, sir, because of that.
If one student has scored 80% marks and the other scored 60% marks, then we can't allocate it. Because as per the dean of instruction, is that the allocation has to be done on a percentage basis. So we can't help it.
Okay.
Any other question?
Please mark my attendance.
What's your name?
Sir, Deepika Jain.
Deepika, your roll number?
410.
Sir, mine too.
Wait a minute, let's mark the papers first.
Okay.
Ritika or Deepika? What's your good name?
Kanishk.
Kanishk, your roll number?
Sir, 017.
Anyone?
Thank you, sir.
Sir, also zero. My
name?
Mohammed Zafar.
Gaurav Gupta.
What's your roll number and roll number?
020.
020.
013, sir.
013 and 002.
010.
Anyone else?
From 502.
What's your name?
010.
Fine. Anyone else who has left out?
Sir, bro.
Okay, then fine. We hang up the class and we see the next lecture.